Hello everyone, I am Bob and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining channel. In this design series episode, we're going to cover how to add Bitcoin heating to a house heated by an existing forced air furnace. So with that, let's get started. Okay, so in the last episode, I covered four different setups for heating your house with Bitcoin. I've got a link above to that episode if you want more information. Of these four different types of setups, I'm going to start with this one first. A setup where a house is heated by forced air heating and the miners are on all the time, nonstop. Now, with this setup, as with all the others, one thing to keep in mind is that whatever you build, this is going to be experimental in nature. Your mining equipment may fail, your setup may not work as planned, or your Bitcoin heating may not provide quite enough heat to keep your house warm in the winter. And so it's a really good idea to make sure you have a backup in case something goes wrong. And the way to accomplish this is to keep the existing forced air heating system intact so you can always fall back on it and avoid freezing during the winter. So for this setup, we'll start with an existing forced air furnace. This type of furnace has a return side plenum where the cold air enters the furnace and a supply side plenum where the heated air exits the furnace and flows to your house. The furnace itself consists of a burner and heat exchanger that work together to heat up the air and a large fan which forces that air through the house. Now, all furnaces are designed to run in a fan-only mode, where the burner is off but the fan is turned on to circulate air through the house. And the key to heating your house with Bitcoin heat is to take advantage of this fan-only mode. The way this works is to add a water-to-air radiator into the ducting exiting the furnace. The hot fluid from your Bitcoin miner setup is pumped through this radiator, and then the furnace is put into fan-only mode to circulate air through the radiator and around the house, heating your home with Bitcoin miner heat. Now, this type of setup is not anything new. People have been heating their homes with wood-fired water heaters using this same setup for a very long time. We're just replacing the wood-fired water heater with a Bitcoin miner water heater. And so all the equipment, accessories, and the methods and knowledge to build these systems is available if you know where to look. I put a few links below with more information. Now, before getting into the design, I want to note that all of this is only going to work well with a dual-loop Bitcoin mining system. Most all of the pumps, radiators, valves, and other hardware are made for glycol water mixtures, so a single loop system circulating dielectric fluid will likely cause some problems. I covered single loop versus dual loop systems in a previous video if you want to know more. Getting into the design, the first part of the system to figure out is that water to air radiator that goes into the hot air output of the furnace. And the big question to ask is, how big of a radiator should you use? And the answer is, as big as you can fit into your ducting. The larger the radiator, the more heat you can transfer from your mining setup to your air, and the less restriction you'll add to your existing home heating system. And this brings up something you'll have to check with an HVAC expert. When you add this radiator, you're going to be adding a restriction to your furnace airflow. This might reduce how much hot air can be delivered to certain rooms in your house, and you might have to increase your fan speed to compensate. An HVAC expert will let you know if that's possible and if there's any other downside to adding this radiator to your furnace. In any case, there are a ton of different sizes of water-to-air radiators out there, and you should be able to find one that closely fits your duct size. And if you can't find one exactly the right size, it's always a good idea to go a little bigger and use ductwork to make up any size differences. I have links below for water-to-air radiator sources. Now, cutting up your ducting and installing the radiator might seem a little intimidating, but actually, it's really not that hard at all, particularly if you have the right tools and techniques. To help here, I found a great YouTube channel out there called the DIY HVAC Guy, where an experienced HVAC technician shows you how to build and modify ducting using very quick and very easy techniques and really cheap tools. I highly recommend giving him a watch. His videos will show how easy it really is to modify your ducting. With the water-to-air radiator selected, the next part of the design is connecting the radiator to the rest of the miner cooling loop. And this is where things can get a little tricky. The goal here is to keep the miners running nonstop. This means that a continuous flow of cooling fluid must pass through the Bitcoin miner brazed plate heat exchanger at all times. And so we'll need some way to control how much fluid goes through the radiator in the furnace and how much fluid goes through the dry cooler outside the house, so that all of the fluid returning to the heat exchanger stays cool enough to keep the miners from overheating. Now, there are a few different ways to get this to work. You could build in a temperature sensor connected to some sort of modulating valve with some sort of controller. You could also use manual balancing valves and try to keep them adjusted just right. But I think I found a much simpler and automatic way to make this work. And that is to use what is called a thermostatic valve or thermal balancing valve. The way this type of valve works is a small chunk of wax within the valve is connected between the valve components. This wax expands and contracts based on the temperature of the fluid passing through the valve and automatically controls how much fluid passes through the valve. These valves are made to throttle a high temperature source flowing into radiators to keep the temperature of the fluid in the radiator low. By positioning this valve at the output of the water to air radiator and turning the temperature setting of the valve down to the fluid temperature we want returning to the miner, this should automatically control how much fluid passes through the radiator. If the airflow through the radiator isn't pulling a lot of heat from the fluid, the temperature at the thermostatic valve will increase, and the valve will shut down, preventing hot water from returning to the Bitcoin cooling loop. The Bitcoin cooling loop fluid flow will then pass mostly through the dry cooler. If instead the radiator starts pulling a lot of heat from the fluid, the temperature at the thermostatic valve will decrease, and the valve will open up, allowing more fluid to pass through the radiator. Now, the limit to how much fluid can get to the radiator is going to be dependent on the relative flow restrictions between the two fluid paths. For this configuration to work, the flow path through the radiator must be less restrictive than the flow path through the dry cooler. And it's not that hard to make this work. The dry cooler will likely be further away, resulting in more fluid resistance. You could also make the piping to the radiator a lot bigger than the piping to the dry cooler. Or you could add balancing valves to restrict the flow to the dry cooler. Now, another part of the system to think through is what to do during the summer months. Most likely, the ducting of your forced air heating system is also the ducting of your air conditioning system. It's going to be really important to shut off any fluid from flowing through the radiator, or you might be heating your house when you don't want to. Now, thermostatic valves are not made to completely cut off fluid flow, so you'll need another valve in line to completely isolate the radiator. And this is what zone valves are made for. These are simple, electrically operated valves designed to stop fluid flow to different parts of a hydronic or hot water system. Inserting a zone valve in front of the radiator should isolate the radiator so all fluid is directed to the dry cooler during summer months. With all of the piping in place, the next big question to ask is how to control the heat. Your house already has a thermostat that automatically turns your furnace on or off, keeping your home comfortable. And we can add to that thermostat so your Bitcoin heater will work together with your existing furnace. Now, there's a ton of variation here in what type of thermostat you might have and how it is wired to your existing furnace. And so in a future episode, I'll be covering all the details of how to wire everything together so that your Bitcoin heater seamlessly works alongside an existing furnace. Okay, so that's all I have for this episode. In the next few episodes, I'm going to continue covering how to heat your house with Bitcoin. I'll be covering the other three setup options, including wiring everything together with your existing thermostat. So with that, bye.